I want to bring up something. I was in a park yesterday. I told Brian about this, and I was doing. Yeah. I was Sunset Park, which I know you're familiar with. I was in Sunset Park yesterday, not because I wanted to be there. I had to be there for work, right? So I'm there, and I noticed people were practicing social distancing, but I saw people playing basketball, soccer, and I'm like, "What are you doing? Why are you doing this right now?" I know that you've been encouraging the residents of Brooklyn. You'd encourage people throughout New York City and throughout the country. You should be staying safe. Am I wrong in saying basketball or soccer is a thing that you should probably not be doing right now?
No, you said it. You said it best and clear, and you're right. People really have not completely comprehended where we're at. And I know it's sort of difficult because we live in a country for the most part that has been stable. You know, outside of 9/11, we don't have attacks on our shores. We don't know what it is to hear bomb sirens. We're used to our freedom. China can shut down the whole country and no one is going to argue. We take a lot of pride in saying, you know what, you're not going to tell me what to do. That is the country we live in. And so we're actually being penalized because we live in such a free society. But we need to really now understand what this means. This means that, yes, you may be strong enough to play basketball, get coronavirus, and cycle out. But what about your grandmother? What about your mother? What about the person in your house that has asthma or that's diabetic or has a pre-existing respiratory condition? And so people need to understand that, yes, you may be able to survive and just get a serious reaction that is really dramatic in itself. But other people can lose their lives. And so I think it's important that, number one, our law enforcement officials must do a soft touch. We're not talking about harassing and arresting, but a soft touch of telling people there is a stay-in-place order. Recreation, because it's therapeutic, but you have to engage in it when you're doing your social distance. You should be jogging alone. You should be doing your speed walking alone. You can shoot hoops by yourself. So the goal is, if you want to stay engaged and healthy and relieve the stress, there's a way to do it that people are safe. And one-on-one basketball, checking each other, is not a safe way to do it.
When did the seriousness of the virus first hit you? Like, when did it first register to you as it was coming about? Like, yo, this could be something that really shakes the city and obviously beyond that, the world.
That's a great question. And for some time, you know, I'm in this health space after reversing my diabetes by using medicine and food. And it put me into this place of really started looking at, I said, wait a minute. If diabetes was able to, you know, reverse my blindness, reverse my nerve damage, reverse all my medical conditions, I started to say, well, let me examine what is going on here. And as I started reading and reading and started listening to what some of these medical and health professionals doing a few TED Talks and listening, I said, wait a minute, we got an issue about to happen. And so 2 weeks ago, when this got on the radar here in the city, About 3 weeks ago when I heard in China, I started looking again and doing some more research that I took notes of. And I said, this is what they've been talking about. We're about to get hit with something here. And then when we got our first case here, I started to say it's going across the globe. And then we saw the increase. Our numbers are increasing at such a fast rate. You know, we are moving at an extremely large rate, the number of deaths. And the analysis of this, that I knew last week, particularly after speaking to my doctors, the presidents of 2 weeks ago, after speaking to the presidents of my hospital, that they said, Eric, this is we had a real crisis right now. Now, 9/11 happened. We got hit in the gut. 9/12, we were able to get up and start rebuilding. We went from the strike to the rebuilding mode, the investigation mode, etc. This is a different baby. This is not a 2 week issue. We're looking potentially to peak in June, and this can go all the way to August. So this is not a shutdown. Okay, for 2 weeks, we're just going to shut down and then we're going to bounce back. No, no. Our hotels are closing. We're laying off hundreds of thousands of employees. Our restaurants are closing. Our churches that were already dealing with crises, they're closing. They may have to close down. We're looking at all of these employees that are going to be hit. Our teachers, you know, our entire school system is under attack. So we need to understand, going back to your question about taking this lightly, this is not a light issue. This is a real issue that many of us have never experienced before. Never. And part of the people you see in the park have lived in an invincible generation that feels nothing can harm them or impact them. So we can go to Miami for spring break. We can just hang out in the park. We're dealing with a body of young people who have never had to endure the Great Depression, never had to endure the attack of Pearl Harbor, and some of them never even endured the attack of 9/11. So many of our young people, this is something that they cannot even comprehend, and that's why we need sports figures like the LeBron James, the Steph Currys. We need the Jay-Z's, the Beyoncé's. They need to be part of the narrative to say to the young people, hey, this is real that we're dealing with, and our hip-hop pop culture needs to be a part of this, because they don't want to hear from Eric.
VP, you say you're too old for anybody to listen to you? I don't think that's true.
Why do you feel like that's the connecting point, though? Like, it always seems to be athletes, entertainers, and just people of that ilk. Why do you feel like that's always sort of the connecting point to people who are, I guess, in this case, millennial or Generation Z?
No, and that's not the only. I mean, there's some great influences out there. Those are some folks that on the top of my head, but there's some great influences. You know, when you look at the social media, you know, some of the folks who are having talks, Twitter feeds, you know, doing analysis. We should spend time of doing an analysis of everyone that has 5,000, 10,000, 20,000, 100,000, a million listeners. They can play a major role of engaging in it. That's why we're doing these podcasts. You guys have a strong listenership, and we're saying, let's use our podcast, because you are influencers. People listen to what you're saying. Right. And if you engage in these real conversations, so it doesn't have to be the ball player, the tennis player, but they too have a body of people who join them. I mean, if any, you know, Beyonce, she has a Beyonce following. Yeah. You know? When she went plant-based, a whole lot of folks started doing plant-based. You know, so the reality is that our pop stars, our athletes, our entertainers, they have a segment of people that they can influence. And there's another group of influencers that are coming up on social media. I think we need to better use them. We have not caught up on how to better use these influencers.
Right. Now BP, you know, you talk to a lot of people across Brooklyn. You have your ear to the streets, as we like to say. What are you hearing from people about what the real concerns are about this? Because when I speak to people, a lot of concerns is, hey, what happens if we're losing jobs? You kind of touched on some of this before, right? Like, how does this affect the economy and trickle down to us? What are you hearing from people that I know reach out to your office and say what their concerns are? What are you hearing about that?
Listen, man, people are scared shitless, man. People are really scared. And on average, we get about 100 calls a day on different problems. Because one thing that you said that's so important, the appearance of coronavirus didn't disappear the crises that people were facing already. Mm. We're already catching hell. And so now, just because we got coronavirus, we're not all of a sudden, you know, forgetting about the crises that people were facing. Now, we put out a call to end evictions during this period of time for, I believe, 90 days. You know, so folks are not going to be thrown out of their homes. We're dealing with not to freeze mortgages on, you know, small units. We think it should go to everyone at the time the federal government needs to stand in. So we're doing things to try to hold back some of the crises that people were dealing with. But folks are still dealing with some crises.
Yeah.
And so take this additional crisis and drop it on folks. It's a real issue. We have households where people are experiencing domestic violence. Yeah. And now you have to stay in a household together for the next 4 or 5 months. That domestic violence is not going to disappear just because coronavirus. We have young people who are in homeless shelters. They don't have Wi-Fi connection to get the mobile learning that the school is dealing with. Mm. We got to address that. And so people are saying, Eric, in addition to this coronavirus, and that is some of the response that you're seeing. You know, I remember on September 11th, after the Trade Center was attacked, I remember when I got off, we were doing 12-hour tours as a cop. And I remember when I got off, I said, let me go into, you know, the hood over on Mother Gaston and just see how folks are doing and just talk to some of the young people in the street. Cats were just playing ball in the park, man. I said, y'all didn't hear what happened at the Trade Center? They said, Eric, we were catching hell when those buildings were up. So folks are saying to themselves, man, we were already catching hell before coronavirus came.
Right.
And that's why, you know, when you have been desensitized to trauma, it is hard for you to even identify what emergency is. You desensitized.
Are you concerned, BP? Because you brought up something there about the folks that are desensitized to trauma. My concern around this sometimes is that when we talk about everything in this, that sometimes those folks are the ones that are going to get forgotten. Are you concerned about that as well, too? Because that's a big concern for me.
I love that question. And let's break down what you just said. Such a powerful question that you just asked. There was a call put across the city and country that if you could telecommute and stay home. Who telecommutes?
Right, right.
Correction officers that are 80% Black and Hispanic can't telecommute. Bus drivers and train operators, predominantly Black and Hispanic, they can't telecommute. You know, telecommute, the mayor said that 10% of the 350,000 plus city employee staff are non-essential and they could telecommute. Those are managers.
Right.
Those are not hourly employees. You know, they're still on the train. They're not staying home with their family. And so when we use these terms, we got to dig into those terms because telecommuting is not Miss Maria who is cleaning someone's house. Mm. You know, she can't do that from her internet or from her computer. She may not even have Wi-Fi. You know, it's not a John who is doing the janitorial service. So you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
And so
right.
Those people are being forgotten. That's why I want to do an analysis of how we tested the entire borough in the entire state. Because when I talked to the president of Downstate Hospital, he says, Eric, when we were told by CDC that after a person is showing serious advanced stages of a flu-like symptoms and what appears to be coronavirus, you test them to determine it's not the flu or other things, and then you request from the Department of Health to test them for coronavirus. So the only way back then you could get a test for coronavirus is after you go over those two hurdles. He said for every 10 people we sent to the Department of Health in the downstate, Central Brooklyn, Black and Hispanic, mm-hmm. he said for every 10, we got 1 approval, 9 disapprovals. Hmm. So maybe the numbers are low in Brownsville, Crown Heights, South Jamaica. Maybe they're low is because we're not testing these areas. Hmm. So we're not testing these areas. We're not identifying the real emergency in the cluster, and we're not bringing the right supplies to those areas. I think we're creating two different cities, those who are getting the resources they need and those who are not. And so if I can telecommute because I'm a manager and I'm getting paid more than everyone else, I can telecommute. I'm home with my child, with my family. I'm providing for them, but that other family member who couldn't afford childcare in the first place, who is on the train with everyone else, who's going to and from their job, we're creating two cities. No, one city. Those who are paid more, give more, and do more.